I'd love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my fame and glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story. 'Tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my fame and glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when it sings of glory, I sing the new song. 'Twill be the old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme and glory to tell the old story of Jesus and His love.
Good morning. We're predominantly going to be, or that means most of the time, we're going to be in Joshua chapter 24 today. So if you want to open your Bible, if you want to flip on your smartphone, if you want to look to the front, be in God's Word. We went to a church recently. We were really frowned on for looking at our phone at the Bible. I don't have a problem with it. I want you to have God's Word. I don't care where you get it as long as it's God's Word. Amen. I don't care if you like ice cream. I don't care what flavor you like, as long as it's ice cream. Amen? That's how I am about it. I want people to get the Word. And I don't want to put hurdles between them and that. I want to remove as many hurdles as I can, because I want them to know what God wants to tell them. So that's where we are this morning. It says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The substance, right? Things hoped for. I want you to grab right now. We just got some friends back from Greece. Slick place to visit, I'm sure. Yeah. How was it?
It was wonderful.
Oh, good. Good. Glad you're all back safe. You got lots of pictures to share?
Yes.
Awesome. We even went to Turkey.
After Thanksgiving. That's interesting.
Thanks.
Okay. That's right. Yeah. You got to walk where Paul traveled.
Yes. Where Paul preached in Ephesus.
Wonderful, wonderful. Look forward to hearing it. Again, glad you are back safe, and thanks for getting the calendar out so quick, too. On the first day of the year, that's good to have a calendar deal with. Well, listen, substance. I want you to grab right now the trip that you're planning for next year and show it to me. The trip that you're going to take next year. Can you grab it right now and show it to me? You can't. Why not?
Don't know what it is.
It's in the future. So you can't, but you can do what? You can have hope for it. And you can show me your hope for it, can't you? And the Bible says that's substance. That what God's got planned for us, we can hope for. That's called faith for the future. And it's got substance. It's not just something that's so abstract. Can you see it in people's faces when they hope for their eternity with Jesus? He says you can. And said, if they've got enough faith, it's going to show. No matter what the news says on TV, right? It's going to show. Yeah, I know there's all that, but I'm looking to Jesus. I'm looking to His promise. No matter who's in the White House or the Green House or wherever. Amen? Yeah. It don't matter. Because Jesus is going to have it. Why do the nations rage when God's got it all under control? And they do. And they enjoy it. And they like getting the energy, the negative energy out of it for all of us to worry with. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus. Amen. Here's the next part of that, though. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. One more time. Faith is the evidence of seeing things not seen. In a court that does it right, nobody gets convicted without evidence. Do you agree? They're not convicted on opinion. They're convicted on evidence. And it should be shown. And it should be legit. Well, God says we get to present evidence to a lost and dying world with our what? With our faith. And the world says it's foolish. You can't see what you believe in. And I often want to tell them, then I want you to come to Louisiana during a hurricane, go pick up a down power line. That's down power line, I said. Yeah. Right? Will you do it?
No.
You see a big old power line run on the ground. How many are going to go pick it up? Why not? It could be your last. You may have a shocking experience, right? Right, it could be a lot. But you can't see electricity. That means it's not there, right? How dumb would it be to go pick up a down power line? It would be dumb. Because it quits talking about what you can see and what you can't see. I can't see the internet running into this thing, which it does sometimes, and sometimes it don't when it's supposed to. But I can't see it, but it works, doesn't it? Okay, so evidence to people who don't know the Lord is your faith. It's my faith. Doesn't it say it right there on the wall in gray and white and off-white? Doesn't it say it there? Doesn't it say it on your smartphone? Doesn't it say it in your Bible? Faith is what? Evidence of things not seen. That's become so important because we live in a world that more and more, we shared some statistics last week of how many people are staying away from church. How much fewer people believe in God at all. And the groups that are staying furthest away are the ones who lean to the world's understanding of things, the most the progressive and those kind of people that think that way. Because God can't save the world, so we have to. We're going to fix it. Because we only have 12 years. How many of you have heard that statement before?
About 10 times.
Well, I'm not 120, but I've heard it several times. Over the last 20 years, have you? We've only got 12 years. We've only got 12 years. Poor polar bear's fixing to fall off that little ice thing cube that he's floating on, right? All that kind of stuff. Listen, be a good steward of God's creation. I don't have a problem with that, but that's not what's going to save the world. Amen? It won't save a single soul. It won't save one single soul from eternity of being away from God. Okay? So we need to show people who think we're foolish because we believe in something we can't see. We need to show them evidence that what we can't see exists with our what?
Faith.
With our faith. And if we don't show it, what do we look like? Everybody else. What do we look like if we don't show our faith? Everybody else. And there's no evidence. There's no evidence that's going to save anybody if our faith isn't showing it. Does that make sense? All right. With that stated, we're going to go way back in the book of Joshua. Excuse me. Joshua is an interesting guy. He was with Moses when he started way back in Egypt. He went the 40 years. Right? One of the spies, Joshua and Caleb, went. Then Moses, who represented the law in the Bible, people think you're going to get to heaven by keeping all the rules. Did you know that that's not going to do it? Did you know the law can't save one person? Because nobody can keep the whole thing. And you break one part of it, it's like I got 99% of my boat looks fine in the middle of the ocean, but I got that one little hole. What happens with that one hole? You sink. Amen? But what he can do, the law can do, is point us to the answer. Which is Jesus, who can keep the law perfectly and did. Amen? And took our place. And we get to share His righteousness. He gives that to us when we accept Him. How many of y'all know how to accept Him?
Romans 10:9.
Romans 10:9 will tell it. John 3:16 tells several others, but let's do Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Lord, the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Let's say another way. You shall go to heaven. Let's say another way. You shall spend eternity with Jesus and not in hell.
Amen.
You shall be saved. Romans 10:9 is my favorite one to tell that to folks with. I love the steps that it shows. But it, remember, the biggest thing is it has to be in your heart. Believe in your heart, not some superficial line that you say, Jesus is my Lord. I want to try to follow him better this year. How many are resolved to try to follow him better this year? Wonderful. Tomorrow, go ahead and make that resolution again.
Yes.
And the next day, make it again. Right? Take up your cross daily. Amen? Because this human body will fight against that. It will do that. All right. Now, Joshua, Moses died. Joshua, the way the Jewish people say it is Yeshua. Yeshua, they, instead of Joshua, that's how they do it with their emphasis on different syllables. Okay? But that's the word. Now, if you say it in the Greek, how do you say Joshua in Greek? Jesus. Jesus is the name for the Greek form of saying Joshua. Did you know that? Now you know. Okay? So Joshua, we got the law. And right after the law shows up, Yeshua, Jesus. But we get that picture in the Old Testament. God does that all the time in the Old Testament. He gives us pictures of what's going to come true, or more true. It's true when it happened, but it's even more true when the fullness of the revelation shows up. So, what happens? Well, Moses took them across the Red Sea. God parted the Red Sea. How many of you remember that story? And when they finally got through wandering around in the wilderness, Joshua led them across the Jordan River that was at flood stage until they went across with the Ark of the Covenant, and it dried up and they all crossed through there. And everybody says, wow, this Joshua guy must be the next leader. God did that for him. And who's he taking across the river? God's people. Remember that. God's people. And now we're at the end of the book of Joshua. What's happening there? Well, the walls of Jericho fell. How many of y'all heard about that? That amazing military mind that he had. Let's march around the city a few times and not say nothing and shout and blow our horns and it'll drop. Put the band out front and lead the attack. Does that sound like a good military strategy to you? Because it wasn't the military that dropped the walls. What was it? God. What did it take for God to act? Their obedience. Do you trust me? Do you trust me to do something as weird as this? You trust me to say to someone you can't even see, you're my Lord now. And after you've done that, go show everybody, hey, I've got a new Lord that you can't see, but I'm going to show you my faith. I'm going to go get dumped in some water. Does that sound even sane? Sounds downright foolish, doesn't it? I pray that I'm the most foolish person you know, because that'll be my faith show. By the world's eyes, I pray I'm the most foolish person that you know. And I pray that you're the most foolish person I know, because you're not afraid to show your faith. Does that make sense? Because we need more evidence. There's all kind of evidence every day in the blues. I mean the news that shows up. There's all kinds of negative, false. I know it's true for the moment, temporary, but it's false for the eternity. Junk that gets told. All right? So here he is. Joshua's come across the river. He brought God's people with him. Got a lot of experiences through the book of Joshua. It's right before the book of Judges. We'll talk a little bit about that. Okay? But after he gets through it and he's fixing to die, how many of us know that we got to get rid of this body to get to the place where God is? Because we're made of dirt, and the dirt is cursed. You can find that in Genesis. We're going through Genesis now. It's cursed, and you're not going to get there in this body. How many are ready to get shed of this body anyway and get one that'll last forever? One that functions a little better and doesn't hurt all the time. Right? Some of us are of that age. We can remember which song goes ahead of the other, especially when we're the one that put them in order. You know? That's how it goes. All right? So, it says in the beginning, and this is narrative. This is a story. I'm going to read it to you in a modern translation because it'll sound more like story. You check it out with whatever legitimate version that you think is right. I have no problem with that. There's some illegitimate versions out there. I have a problem with those. Jesus wasn't a God, he's the God. Amen? And that's where you can tell certain things about an illegitimate one out. So let's pray and get started. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for what you're going to teach us today. Thank you for another year to not only experience you, Lord, but to show the evidence of your existence and what you have for us by living by faith. I pray we get better at it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Joshua summoned all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, including their elders, leaders, judges, and officers, and they came and presented themselves to God. So how many of y'all know where Shechem is? It's really hard to find. You got to go to Google and write Shechem. Then hit the one that says map. That's what I do. I'm not smarter than anybody else. I just go look in the book or the phone or the whatever. Okay. And you know where Shechem is? You got Israel. Three of them will fit in Florida. But it's like this big. You got Galilee up there, Samaria in the middle, and Judah at the bottom. And right here in the middle is Shechem. So if you're going to call a big meeting for everybody there, what's a good place to call them? To the middle, right? So that's where Shechem is. And they get there. Everybody's coming, at least the leaders are, but it includes the leaders. And Joshua said to the people, this is what the Lord, I love how it does the capital L, the Lord, not a Lord, the God, I'm glad it says capital G, not a God, the God of Israel says, long ago, your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River, and they worshiped other gods. How many of you have been doing the Genesis study with us, and you already know that? Okay? And if you want to do the Genesis study, my sister-in-law actually is redoing our website, and you go find where it says Bible studies, and you hit Genesis, and you can go read through that. It's a lot more orderly than it was. I mean, we've said before, if you want an app on your phone, come see me, grab a sheet of paper, and you can have it. You can get to that anytime. Okay? Don't substitute that. Don't substitute it for forsaking gathering together. We need you. I need help. Y'all saw Brother Kevin helping me earlier. I need help. And God says to be sure and gather together. Satan's like a wolf pack that loves to get the caribou off by itself so it can overpower it. Amen. But the ones that stay in the group, they're pretty safe. Right? Be with the group. Be counted among those who are the family of God. We need you. I need you. Amen. And God says do it. That should be fine. So let's continue. It says, Terah was the father of Abraham. And where they lived? The other side of the Euphrates River. South of Babylon. Way down there. And they worship other gods. How many knew that Abram was a pagan? How many knew that? He was a pagan. Right? And God called him out of a lost and dying, eternally dying world. He called him from that. So where did God get us? Same spot. Okay? Mesopotamia is where that was, but being a lost and dying world. If you're saved, it's because God did what? His spirit showed you that these words we're talking about are true. You saw enough evidence of other people. And God led you. And you said, I'm going to trust Jesus more than I am all these experts out there that want to sell me some fish oil or a ShamWow or whatever else that they've got for sale today. Or this theory about this disease or that theory about that war or whatever else they want to sell us today. I trust God more. He had never lied. I know y'all, some of y'all got politicians never lied to you, but God really hasn't ever lied to you, right? And His Bible and the truths that have shown show me that He hasn't lied. And I've seen that faith in many people, some who've gone to be with the Lord. And I have lots of evidence, not only of His existence, but of His power over death. I have lots of evidence of that. And I want to be part of that evidence in the future. Anyway, they worshiped other God. Then God said, I took your ancestor Abram from the land of the Euphrates and led him to the land of Canaan. We call that the promised land. I gave him many descendants through his son, Isaac. And those descendants he gave through Isaac became known as the Hebrew people, the Jewish people. He had another son through not God's plans, but the way of the flesh or what man thought of. That didn't work out so well. It actually created an enemy for Israel that goes on today. In general, there have been many Arabs who have become Christian, but in general, the Arab nations don't like the Jewish nations, and they want to run them into the sea. And I'm just quoting what the Blues News says. All right? That's what they want to do. Anyway, but he says, through this one, it's so strange, Abram was thought to be too old to have kids. His wife was definitely thought to be old to have kids. And God gave him a child. Why? Because he wanted a nation that could go tell the world and show the world what faith looks like. And that God is, and that God would rather die than see anybody go to hell. And he did on a cross. Amen. But he had a people chosen to do that. And what was interesting, he didn't go get the most powerful nation. He didn't get the second most powerful. He didn't get the third most powerful nation. He said, I'm going to make one out of people too old to have kids. Why? So we knew it was God. And he did to Abram and Sarah. He got a multitude, and we call them the Hebrew people. And first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. If you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. And he gave us the word of God. Jesus came through the Jewish people, all of those. And it started with this guy, Abram, who was a pagan in a foreign land. And God called him to the promised land. He said, to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. To Esau I gave the mountains of Seir. How many know where the mountains of Seir are? If you've been to Petra, you've been to the mountains of Seir. Did y'all go, or no, was your son that went?
Christopher
went to Petra and saw that. Where's that? Well, you go down to the Dead Sea, go a little bit further south and take a lift. And you'll be at that place. And that became the place where Esau's family went. He wasn't the promised, where the seed of Christ would go through. That would be through Jacob. How many of y'all heard of the 12 tribes of Jacob? Again, the Jewish nation. But Esau wasn't one of those. He said, so I put them over there. And he says, and Jacob and his children went down to Egypt. They left the promised land. Joseph, one of the sons, had gone down there. He started off a slave and a prisoner, accused of all kinds of wrong things. And what did God do? Made him the number two of the most powerful nation on earth. Does that have a picture in there to you? Was Jesus accused of things that he didn't do?
Oh, yeah.
Was he a prisoner? For a little while, they went so far as to execute him, but he escaped. He was dead, but death couldn't hold him. Amen. But he became, when he went to heaven, at the right hand of the Father. We would think of number two in the Godhead. One God shows up three ways. But you see that picture in Joseph and Pharaoh. And all things were turned over to Joseph. The Father's going to put all things under Jesus' feet, remember? Lots of pictures that God put in the Old Testament to show us exactly what he was doing as he rolled out his plan for us. He didn't change anything. He rolled out the plan that was already written. And he said when he finished Revelation, that's it. There's no more to add. Don't add or take away anything from what I've given you. So when you have got somebody says, oh, I got something new that God's saying. No, he didn't. If it don't line up with the old, it's not there. Now, can he talk to you from the old? Absolutely. All the time. Anyway, so the kids went down to Egypt. They stayed there. Good while. Started off good. They even got in a separate spot so that they weren't intermarrying and pulling another culture in. They became, I'd hate to use it this way, but a pure culture, the group of people God wanted, a distinct culture of them. They're not perfect yet. Okay, but they are a distinct culture, all right? And God allowed the culture to grow, the group of people to grow, and then he brought them back. And that's where we got into. There's a story about Moses, because he said, then I sent Moses and Aaron. Aaron went as the priest, all because Moses says, I can't do it by myself. I don't want to get Aaron to do it. Well, I'll send him with you, you know? We often argue away God's best. Aaron caused some problems for Moses. Do you remember? This gold calf, there's some gold down there, and all of a sudden I popped a calf. That was Aaron's excuse. Don't always trust the clergy. Amen. He was a high priest and he lied. Right? Trust God absolutely every time. All right? Anyway, he said, so I brought, he made it tough for Pharaoh and him. He brought terrible plagues in Egypt. And afterwards, I brought you out as a free people. You're no longer under the bonds of the world, of the world situation. He brought a free people out of there. Who ensured their freedom? Did they train their armies good enough to be commandos to go take on Pharaoh? No, God did it all. And it was an ideology. Those plagues that he sent showed that their little g gods that they worship were nothing compared to what the God, the only God, could do. And so he took that out of their minds and their hearts. When your ancestors cried out to the Lord, I put darkness between you and the Egyptians. Remember when they're going to the Red Sea and the Egyptians are following, they got mad again and they're coming to wipe them out? And God put them into what? Bewilderment and darkness. He blocked them off where they couldn't get there. He says, I brought the sea crashing down on the Egyptians, drowning them. They crossed on dry land. The Egyptians started to follow. And God says, you don't learn, do you? That's my picture of it. Boom. End of the Egyptian army. So much for the strongest, most powerful nation in the world. The so-called defenseless ones want to have God as their leader and their defender, and they're on the other side and they're safe. And I would love to tell you, and they lived happily ever after, but they didn't. They got on the other side and they realized they didn't bring their lunch kit. McDonald's was closed. They had nothing to eat. And they said, what, there weren't enough graves in Egypt to bury us there? You brought us over here to kill us. And that's the kind of thought that they had. Do we start complaining about God when things don't go our way? I can't believe a righteous God will let 9/11 happen. How many of y'all have heard that? I can't believe a righteous God would do this and that. If you want to disbelieve, you absolutely have that choice. I do believe we run away from God, we can expect things to happen. And I tell you this, you can follow God and expect things to happen. They did it to Jesus, why wouldn't they do it to us? And I submit to you, 2023 is probably going to be worse than 2022. I shared the other morning at the breakfast that on the internet somebody put something down about the evolution theory. And I wrote, well, I'm just foolish enough to believe that God done it. And you'd have thought that I popped somebody's balloon big time. One says, you're right, you sure are foolish. One says, well, you're foolish, but you're honest. Another said, I thank Zeus that God doesn't, that he doesn't let you teach our kids. And I thought that was interesting, being a retired school teacher, you know. But I wrote a couple of those things. I put that was on the place that it's foolishness, right, to believe in something you can't see. But the Bible says that our faith is evidence. And so, thank you for calling me foolish, because he just says I don't go with the world's theories. And I pray that one day you get this kind of foolishness. Wasn't putting down. I've been there myself, right? So all of those things that did happen. And it's going to get worse. There weren't many defenders on that little chat that was going on. But I didn't enter into big arguments. I just kept presenting faith. Anyway, with that stated, these people who got that far almost immediately forgot what God had done for them. It says, finally, I brought you into the land of the Amorites on the east side of the Jordan. And they fought against you, but I destroyed them before you. I gave you victory over them, and you took possession of that land. The Amorites, how many of you know where they lived? I didn't either, so I took my little phone and I got the map. And guess where they lived? Right next to those Babylonians and that group where Abraham was from. Right next to there, all the way out to the sea, all of those were under the Amorite kingdom, including going through Israel. So you'll see the word Amorite pop up everywhere. But the God tells us, he says, you went around this way on that side of the Jordan River. That's the Amorites I'm talking about that you got into it with. The Bible tells all the stuff that's in there in detail. So if you get confused about, well, there's an Amorite here and an Amorite over here. Yes, they were. Okay? So that's those Amorite people. And they tried to wipe them out. They fought against you. God says, but I destroyed them. How many of y'all remember one of the battles that Moses' group fought? And he was up on the side of the hill watching the battle. And when his arms were up, when his staff was raised up, the Jewish people win. And when it started to go down, I think, wasn't it Joshua and Caleb that held his arms up so that they could win the battle? Why did God do that? Why did he make them hold his hands up? What if they'd have won? They walk back, oh, we're number one, we're number one, all that kind of stuff. Who would they think won that battle?
They
thought they did. Yeah. And I'm going to tell you, when I get the big head or anybody else does, we make bad decisions. Mm-hmm. So it was undeniable that it was only through God that the battle was won. It glorified God. You say, well, why? Why does God need so much glory? Listen, he doesn't need it. You and I do. Glory is putting God in the best light so that we look to where he is. If he's not glorified, you don't see him, you're left on your own. You won't look that way. No one seeks after God, no, not one, the Bible says. Right? So we glorify him, and he keeps our eyes on him. And when we're looking up there, other people go, what you looking at? And we get to tell them. We get to tell them what we believe in. So he's glorified because he's glorious, one. But number two, we need it. We need to see him regularly. Anyway, he gave them victory. Then there was this Balak, son of Zippor, king of Moab, which is, I think you're going to be talking about in the book of Ruth, the area where Esau and them were. It says, the king of Moab started a war against him, and he summoned Balaam, son of Beor, to curse. But I wouldn't listen to him. By the way, this Balaam was a prophet, and they paid him off. Remember the clergy? Be careful with clergy. They paid him off to do a curse against them so that they wouldn't win in the battle. But God says, I wasn't listening to that. He said, instead, I made Balaam bless you. Not curse, but bless him. And I rescued you from Balaam. And when you crossed the Jordan River and came into Jericho, the men of Jericho fought against you, as did the Amorites. This is the ones on the other side of the river now. Okay? The Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Gerashites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. I gave you victory over all of them.
All the Ites.
All the Ite family were there. Right? There's one of the guys that we use a study guide. He says, and the men in tights, they get more Ites in there than in the Bible, which we're not supposed to add. You know, but you get all of those Ites, and basically they're all Canaanites. They're the ones in the promised land who are in the way, but God left them there for a reason. And we read about that just a couple of chapters ago in Genesis, why he left them there. The fullness of time hadn't happened. When the fullness of time had, they had it all set up. Okay? He says, I gave you victory over them. And I sent a terror ahead of you to drive out the two kings of the Amorites. It was not your bows and your swords that brought the victory. God done it. All those victories this untrained group of people had were because God did it. We spoke this morning about some of the historic battles. And one case that Brother Doug brought out was about fog and the lack of wind that caused the Americans to win a victory. And the War of 1812. How many, real quick, can tell me when the War of 1812 was fought?
1820.
Good job. It's fun to teach to an educated group. That's a, but anyway, in the War of 1812, we had three major battles, one around Detroit, one in Baltimore, and one on the Battle of New Orleans. How many heard of that one? The Battle of New Orleans. How many learned it in a song years ago?
Yeah.
And that was actually 1814 because it was at the end of the war. Okay, but at the battle at Baltimore, some lawyer wrote a poem about they're bombing that fort all night long. I wonder if it's going to stand till in the morning. How many of y'all have heard that song before? How many of you have sang that song at rodeos before? It's a Star Spangled Banner, right? And he wrote that poem, and they stuck it to some music, some old English music, and now we sing it as a Star Spangled Banner. Well, do you know why they burned the White House, but then all of a sudden they had to quit the battle because they were winning. They got to the Capitol, and they had to quit the battle. Do you know why? Hurricane. How many times do you hear the hurricanes? Not hitting New Orleans, but hitting Washington. There's one. How many times did we need it to happen? One. You know, and has God used America to help the Jewish people, among other people, since then? Yes, he has. So when you see God step in and we recognize it's God, or it's coincidence, or somebody paid off their little g God, or something, they want us to believe that instead of the one true God. Amen? So let's keep going. I gave you land that you had not worked on. The fields were already ready when they got there because these Ites were all there. The ones who had turned away from God, and God had judged them, but it was all there. I gave you towns you didn't build, and towns where you're living now. I gave you vineyards and olive groves for food. They were already set up. It didn't take years. When they got to the promised land, it was ready. How many of you know that Jesus went to prepare a place for you and me, and when we get there, it's going to be ready? I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and bring you unto myself. That where I am, there you will be also. We get pictures, right? We get pictures from the Old Testament, right? So he says, so fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped. Are there any idols out there that people worship today? And I'm not talking about some little statue that people are making.
Money.
It's all kind of thing. Many times it's just an idea. Yeah, we can misuse this smartphone thing and not use it to glorify God. And we can do what with it? By the way, God gave you a body. You can misuse it and not glorify God. Or you can use it to glorify God. But anything that we've got, we can misuse. And Satan just loves it. What does it tell you about your body in modern culture? It's your body. And no matter who it hurts, you take care of your body. Isn't that what's being said? Your body, your choice? Yeah. And it is. I choose, and I am still choosing, and I am still resolving, because it doesn't happen overnight, right? To let God have control of that. I wish I'd made those choices much earlier in my life. It's shameful, the things I've done. But you know what? It shows the long arm of God who would reach even where I've been and pull me from there to here. Right? I'm not here to judge anybody who had misused their body or their cell phone or anything else. I'm here to say there's a better way. And judge me by where I'm seeking to go. I'll fail, but I'm going to do my best to come back with your help. You're my support group. I'm your support group, however you want to call it. Right? To get back on track. Because you call that faith. I got more faith in God's promises than I do in my good doings and even in my bad doings. And so as we keep getting back on track with God, we're giving evidence of that thing they can't see. But there must be something there, because all these people keep looking that way and trying to do that way and even say no to themselves. No, it's your body, it's your choice. Okay, then it's my choice to trust God more than I do this broken brain I got. Amen? All right, so he says, put away, get rid of. And I've said this before, if you're riding around with your Bible app open, or your Bible on your front seat, and you got a fuzz buster on the front of your car and a four-leaf clover or a rabbit's foot, I never have figured out how that's lucky. Wasn't for the rabbit, you know, or whatever it is. Listen, if you want power from something else, sure, you can have that opinion. I'm not going to take that opinion, but God says get rid of it. If you're looking for power from something else, that's your God. Even from circumstances. Well, I'm going to move to where I got better circumstances where I can be more comfortable. God can't use me over there, but that's okay. I didn't want to do that anymore anyway. I'm retired. When do you retire from being a Christian?
Never.
I'll let you answer that.
Never.
All right? He says, but if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. I mean, you get to choose. It is your body and your choice. Right? You do get to choose. You get to choose Jesus Christ in heaven. There's only one name under God where man can be saved, and it's Jesus. Or hell. And people get mad for saying, well, that's your choice. Well, it's your choice. Isn't it? I would tell kids at school, well, you can do your work. Or you can go and call your parents and tell them to come get you, and you can have at it with them. Oh, no, I want a different choice. What choice do you want? I want to play? Distract everybody else and play? No, here's your two choices. You have this one or that one. Make it, and we're going. By the way, if you don't choose the one to do the work, I'm still going to call you parents. That's your choice, right? Get mad for giving a choice. God gave you and me both a choice. Choose him or choose what?
Yeah.
And listen, here's another one. Choose following his way and giving evidence of his being, or choose to be useless for the kingdom of heaven. Useless for my kids and your kids and every other person that comes around you to get to know more about Jesus Christ. He gives us that choice. How many of us says, I want to be useless? You see how dumb it sounds? Right? He says what? What Joshua, Yeshua, says what here? If you refuse to serve the Lord, if you make that choice, then choose today. By the way, why do you make the Hebrew nation? That through the Hebrew nation, we'd have the Word of God, we would have the Messiah, we would have the knowledge of God, all that kind of stuff. But he says, choose today whom you're going to serve. Would you prefer the gods of your ancestors who served beyond the Euphrates? You want to go back and get those defeated gods that I showed you I beat with all those plagues back in Egypt? He says, or would it be the gods of the Amorites? Remember those other ones that God defeated on the way over there? But it's for me and my family. King James says, as for me and my house, as for me and my house, what will we do? Joshua made a choice. We will serve the Lord. we will serve the Lord. You say, Brother Darrell, I'm saved. I don't have to make that choice. I done made the choice. I made Jesus my Lord. Well, remember, Lord implies He's the boss and I follow Him. He's my captain. He's my king. He's my whatever. I gave Him the authority in my life. Well, but once saved, always saved. Well, I tell you, if you're really saved, you're right. The Holy Spirit has sealed you according to Ephesians 1:13, I think it is. Right? I got you. But listen, a couple of things you and I need to know. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Don't play with God. I say that because I love you. Don't play with God. Well, He's okay if I do this. He's okay if I do that. Well, I've got my thoughts about this. Me and Jesus, we got our own thing going. Don't have to worry with that Bible thing. You know what I'm saying? You can come. Listen, He won't be mocked. If you're His, He will chastise you, correct you. Because He don't want you to waste your life. He wants you to have the best. He wants you to live in faith and help other people come to know Him. He doesn't want the blood of Jesus to be wasted. There's plenty of it there for everybody. Amen? But what a waste if others don't get it. So for whatever a man sows, he'll reap. But he'll weep too, probably, I'm sure. Right? And who does He do this with? His kids. Those who have been given the right to be called children of God. He says, if I don't chastise you, you're illegitimate. You're not mine. Remember all those that said, Lord, Lord? And He says, I never knew you. So when He's correcting you, say, praise God, I'm in. Amen? I'm one of His. Something else. We talked about the great falling away from the church and all that other kind of stuff. Listen to what it says as Jesus is telling the husbands how to love their wives. He says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for her. That He, God, might sanctify and cleanse her, the church, as His bride, by the washing of water, by the what?
Word.
What happened when we stay away from God's Word? We hear every other word. Amen? And what do you do when you wash something? You get the scum off of it. How many of y'all like to wash out something and still got a little scum on it and want to go eat, use those utensils and stuff? How many of us get some scum on us? And I'm using a very ugly word, scum. No pretty way to say it, right? Because when we get the world's ways of doing things, what do we have? We get the most destructive thing in the world. We get sin on us and we start saying it's okay. We cease to glorify God and it's all about, well, it's my body, it's my choice. They can go to hell as far as I'm concerned because I'm not going to give them any answers. I like how I feel right now. That's kind of scummy. Would you agree? Okay. What gets rid of it? After you're saved, we're talking about the saved people. The bride of Christ. He says, what? By the washing of the water up by the Word. What happens when we get away from the Word of God? I can tell you what happens. Matthew tells us. He says, you're called like those Hebrew people that he made a people. That weren't a people, He made one, and He made you and I a people, the bride of Christ, the church, to be what? You are the salt of the earth. He called us to be something that influences the world to look to Him. Okay? But what good is salt if it's lost its flavor? What good are we if we're not pointing? What happened to these guys, by the way, if you don't know it, they were kept rebelling against God until he booted them out of the promised land and took them to Babylon. You want to go back where Abram came from when he was a pagan? I'll take you back over there. And he did for 70 years or so. And then he let some of them come back. Then 2,000 years later, he brought a bunch more back, which means the end times are coming in and almost here. But he says, because they didn't do their job, they were corrected for generations. What happens, church, when we don't do our job? He says, what good is salt, us, if it's lost its flavor, if we're not salty enough anymore? Can you make it salty again? No, listen. It should be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. In other words, useless. Useless. You may not notice when you start getting dirty with the sins of the world. How many of you have ever got grease on your hand? Mm-hmm. And you tried to wash the water, did it come off? Finally, you got some of that orange cleaner, that Gojo, and you found a little spot that was a different color than all that other. Right? And you realize, well, I better get the rest of it while I'm here. I pray that when we get washed with God's Word, when it sanctifies us or helps us grow in the Lord and get closer and sensitized to God, that we say, oh, there's more. I got some more work to do here. Not to get saved, but because you are saved and you don't want to be useless. You know people going to hell without the Word of God, and they need evidence. I submit we should all resolve to be better at being evidence to a lost and dying world. And if they call us foolish smile, thank you for noticing. Amen. Thank you for noticing. I'm showing you my foolishness to believe in God over your understanding of the world so that you might see my faith. If you've never made Jesus your Lord, I pray that you do. Even today, what a day, a way to start. A new birth, right? On the first day of the year. And more days to go be, what? Glorifying of God, pointing to God, pointing to this invisible God that you've seen because the Holy Spirit brought that to your mind this morning through His Word. I pray that that would happen today. Yes. He said later, if you finish that reading that chapter, they put a big stone up there. He wouldn't let them make graven images, but He put a big stone. He said, this marks the fact that you said you're going to do like me, and as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. He said, there's your evidence. There's your marker. When you come by it, remember it. Don't forget it. Because what happens when we get too far away? We need soap because we keep getting dirty. We need the Word because we keep getting dirty. Mm-hmm. Amen? Yeah. So, I don't know what the Holy Spirit's told you to resolve today, but I want to be useful. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and go to the Lord and pray.